please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Welcome back. Well, at this point in time, the market's doing reasonably well, a third of a percent higher or 0.4 higher, no matter which index you pick. But clearly, the best performing index today is the Nifty Bank, and it's led from the front by Axis Bank and ICICI Bank. 3.5% higher on Axis Bank and ICICI 2.7 higher.
Well, it's a green morning, all right, and some of those corporate lenders are really at the forefront of it. On that note, let's bring in our next guest on the show. Ashish Puravankara, MD Puravankara, joins us. Now, recently, Shobha, of course, reported some very strong pre-sales numbers. So, Ashish, we thought we'll run it past you and figure out if the trend is really holding for Bengaluru as a whole. So the, you know, the market focus for your company is also Bangalore. Can we expect similar growth numbers from Puravankara?
So the last quarter sales have been good. They've been very encouraging. We launched a project in Bangalore under the Provident brand where we saw really good sales. So, you know, the trend seems good and positive.
Okay. So that's Bangalore. What about other markets? How have they done in Q4?
Yes, so we're currently present in Pune, which is doing well. Hyderabad for us is doing well. We had we just started a pre-launch in Goa, which is quite encouraging. The Bangalore launch did extremely well.
Okay, Ashish, recently reports had suggested there has been a downtick in prices in Pune, in Bangalore, and even in the Mumbai region. We were told that Ahmedabad and Hyderabad have witnessed uptick in prices. Also, that there may be some softness in the IT businesses in the coming quarters. Your views on all these markets?
So our experience is quite the contrary. So if the recent launch that we did in Bangalore, if you take that as an example, it's done extremely well. We've got good pricing as well. So I think it's one needs to really look at which city, which micro market within that city. I strongly believe that a good brand, a well-priced product, still, you know, will see good sales.
Okay, so what's the pipeline looking like? Sales volume grew by 31% in Q3. Affordable segment was about 44%. What's the guidance?
So we don't give guidance on annual sales numbers, but in terms of, you know, the launches, the success of these launches, you know, we're quite excited. So we have about 15 million, like we mentioned, last quarter of launches, 10 million under the Provident brand, around 5 million under the Puravankara brand. Out of the 10 million under the Provident, we have already launched 2 million in Bangalore, which has done well. We have another, we've just started a pre-launch of another 1.9 million square foot in Goa, which is, you know, which is looking good so far. So we're quite excited. We have an additional 6 million of launches for the year under Provident and 5 under Puravankara.
Okay, that's interesting. So a lot of new launches coming up. Two more parameters, Ashish. What is the unsold inventory level at your end? And also current debt position with any reduction targets if you have them?
So in terms of debt today, we've been able to even bring the cost of debt down by another 100 points. So we are currently sitting at 10.67%. Debt would come down on account of, you know, internal accruals, especially sales of the ready-to-move-in inventory. So there's hardly any money to be spent against those. And every sale and accrual out of that bucket goes towards reducing the debt number. In terms of ready-to-move-in inventory, we have seen over the last two, three quarters, the sales have picked up. So there are almost 45 to 50% of our quarterly sales have been contributed by the ready-to-move-in inventory. So that's quite positive and encouraging.
Okay, just stay on the market right now. Just pull out, you know, once again, I just want to refer to both ICICI and Axis. This is what we spoke about in the morning as well. This is 25% of the Bank Nifty, which was in a bit of a bear market, now finding its mojo. And just look at the intraday charts on both these stocks. Even if you bought at the start, you are making money, especially on ICICI, even on Axis now, sustaining that gain. But really the move on ICICI now is really big now. 3% higher is what we have on that. So looking quite interesting. Let's move back to Puravankara. So can you quantify the value of the ready-to-move-in inventory?
So currently, if you see the approximate value of the ready-to-move inventory, which is completely ready, would be in the range of about 600 to 700 crores across projects and across the cities that we are present in.
Okay, and finally, Ashish, what kind of sales are you expecting from the affordable housing space in FY19? Also, any revenue contribution, average realizations that you are expecting in the next year?
So on the per square foot realization, we should see the provident realization go up by at least another 7 to 10% over the next 2-3 quarters because of the new launches that we've had. In terms of contribution, I think the percentage, just because of the sheer volume of provident vis-a-vis Puravankara, and if you look at a blended average, I think provident sales should account for at least about 40 to 45%.
Okay, Ashish, we leave it there. Thanks a lot for your time today. I tell you something, we now have to focus on the market because the Bank Nifty, after a 1,000-point rally over the last 2 or 3 days, is up another 150 points. Really, it's been about large caps. The Nifty also at 10,421 in the zone of resistance. Advanced decline also quite okay. A lot of stocks surging. Really, it's about the two private banks, ICICI and Axis for now. Ashwani Gujral, Mitesh Thakkar back with us. Rajat Bose also joins in. Ashwani, you were talking about chasing the Bank Nifty and especially these two big stocks. What's the call now from here on, and what about individual stocks?
Well, I've never seen people so happy for somebody who's leaving. So my sense is that both these guys should have a trend day. You would recall that yesterday we had gone home with the ICICI Bank calls. So, you know, the more this cleanup picks up pace and the pressure builds up, because yesterday in general news there was, you know, when are these people going to resign, etc. That was going on. So the pressure is on. It's only a matter of time. So that way, I think continue with our Bank Nifty positions. People who don't have it should still take them. Because if you see, HDFC Bank is lower by 0.8. So it's not about all banks. It's just about these problem banks. And now that the issues are getting sorted out, I think there is only upside. Even bad news is getting bought into. So having said that, ICICI Bank, I would still buy with a stop, say, around 280, look for targets of 292. Axis Bank, you would buy with a stop of 524, target of 550. And JSW Steel is a buy with a stop of 308, target of 330.
More rewarding to buy the banks rather than the Nifty Bank, Ashwini?
See, it's more or less the same because the big drivers are moving up. So I would think either would do it. But I think both these stocks, ICICI and Axis Bank, are in strong momentum. So you should expect more gains. They are not going to move 1 and 2%. By the end of the day, they could be, you know, up 4% a piece. And that would take, in turn, the Bank Nifty also higher.
Yeah, what a day it's turning out to be. And today, even, you know, some of the sore spots from yesterday, like IT, even they've started performing today. Reliance is performing today. Banks, metals, what have you. Mitesh, how is it looking and your ideas for now?
Yeah, so I think, you know, it's showing good stability around the 10,420 mark. In case we start capturing it, then as I said, I think, you know, I look at targets close to about 10,540, 10,600 kind of zone being tested again. So we still trade with positive bias. The Bank Nifty is, of course, leading it, but I have two stock calls which are not not from the Bank Nifty, but look individually very good. DVs, after a long time, has managed to get past that 1125, 1135 congestion zone, made a fresh high. That's a buy with a stop at 1130 and look for targets close to about 1225. And the Nifty Infra Index, of which L&T is a good component, and L&T charts are also looking very good. I think both these charts are looking very good. So individually stock, L&T can be bought, keep a stop at 1327 and look for targets of 1380.
Okay. Good morning, Rajat. What do you have for us?
It's a strange day because two of the stocks that I would discuss, apart from the third stock, they are similar to that of Mitesh. I am actually giving futures levels. DV's Lab April futures, I do not elaborate the reasons. That has been adequately elaborated by Mitesh. My stop loss is below 1153 and targets are 1178 and 1189. And L&T, my stop loss is below, again, April futures, stop loss is below 1335, 1357 and 1371 are the two targets for L&T. And all cargo logistics, it has actually given a reversal signal today, having crossed 155, 156 key resistance levels. Stop below 151.80, target 158.80 and 163. I think now you should take only 163 because 158 has already been met.
Okay. By the way, just pull out the intraday chart of PC jewelers.
Oh, yeah. Exactly what I was looking at.
You know, intraday chart of that stock would be interesting. This is a market which is about short covering for now. 4.3% higher is what we have on PC jewelers right now. Ashwani, quick chart check on this one.
I don't think there's any management change here. But I guess, you know, it's not gone up at all in this entire rally. So maybe, you know, one rally back towards 360 is not out of ordinary. It's basically short covering. But even short covering can take things higher, as we are seeing with even sugar.
Oh, yeah. What a move on sugar. Dwarakesh 13, Bajaj Hindustan 8. PC Jeweler, I don't know, Akshay Tritiya is around the corner.
There's
That's
another
on a lighter note.
Actually, there's another set of stocks which we discussed with the power secretary, which this month have been actually the best performers, all the power stocks. GMR is up 23%. This, of course, is a penny stock, so 23% will be all of 4 or 5 rupees. Rel Power is up 16.6%. JSPL also has a power, big power unit, is up 13%. And of course, JSW Energy is up 11%. You will play any of those, Ashwini?
See, these are short covering type candidates, so you know they're good for 5-10%. But as we've seen in the past, that these rallies don't tend to sustain. So I don't think you want to buy them, given that today large private banks are behaving like these power stocks. I think we would stick with that because that's a theme which is now building up.
Across the screen, the banks are performing, metals are performing. We've got great tailwinds from Asian trade. Speaking of metals and other commodities, let's go across to Manisha Gupta. She has a roundup of all the action. Manisha.
Thank you so much for that, sir. We will absolutely. It has been the Chinese premier conversation, or address rather, that has moved the markets quite a bit. All asset classes and commodities are a part of it. So the crude oil prices, after gaining more than 2% yesterday, are trading 0.5% on the higher side. Markets also are looking at geopolitical concerns arising out of Syria. And then, of course, you have those trade, or rather supply concerns coming in from Venezuela and Iran as well. And that has been supportive for the prices. No such luck for the safe haven. So it's not just the currencies where you have seen the Japanese yen and the Swiss franc decline. It's a similar fate for gold and silver in precious metals as well, where you have seen markets actually dumping them and going in for the riskier assets. So it clearly has been the metals as a space which has seen a lot of buying. It actually is the second straight day that you have seen buying continuing here. So 0.5% to 1% up is how we are trading in the Indian markets. And the global markets as well, when you look at Shanghai, is trading 2-3% on the higher side. So whether it is steel, which has continued to gain up for a fourth straight day, or the iron ore prices, which have rebounded from its six-month lows, you are looking at the aluminum prices trading at a six-week highs as well. And the zinc prices have actually come back quite strongly. Remember, we were trading quite in the negative for the last couple of days, but almost a percentage point of a gain or a rebound is what we are looking onto that one. Trading strategies, we have them from Grow Value, and no surprises, it's all buy in case of the metal space there. It starts right from zinc, where the targets are at 214 there. They also have a buy call coming in for copper, 448 is what they're watching out. And nickel as well, a target of 894 on the higher side is what they're expecting for the day today.
All right. Thank you very much, Manisha, for joining us with all those details. With that, let's shift focus back to corporates. We were going to discuss the stock of KEI. That stock has had a good run in April so far, gaining more than 15%. Anil Gupta, Chairman and Managing Director of KEI Industries, joins us now. Mr. Gupta, thank you very much for joining us. First, if you can give us an update on your guidance. You last said you'll be able to achieve 25% growth in terms of value, and the FY18 volume will be at 15%. Any updates?
Yeah, I think we are going ahead with the guidance, and I'll still maintain the same guidance since it is the earning season. So the figures cannot be diverged, but the guidance remains the same, and we will be able to achieve the guided performance.
Okay,
similarly on the volume terms also.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, can you give us then some guidance for FY19 if you have any visibility in terms of orders?
We have an order book position of 2,700 crore at the moment. And with the strong, momentum in our customer base and improvement in our dealer segment and retail sales, we should be able to maintain a growth of 15% to 18% in volumes, volume terms in 18-19, similar to what we have achieved in 17-18. And the turnover growth in value will depend on the commodity prices.
Fair enough. Do you have to add capacity to service this growth, Mr. Gupta, or are you still comfortable? What is the utilization level?
At the moment, our utilization level is around 90%. So the spare capacity what we have, the growth will come from extra high voltage cables. Also, we are in the process of completing our a new greenfield low tension cable plant in Bhiwadi, which is likely to be commissioned by May this year, May 2018, and there will be some capacity addition in HT cables also in the same plant, in the new plant, by end of 2018.
Okay. If I missed it, what is the capacity utilization at the moment?
90%. The capacity utilization at the moment is 90%.
Okay, so you will desperately need your CapEx.
Improving our productivity and efficiency.
Okay.
So this,
yes.
This
we are going to have CapEx.
And when will that come on board, you said, your expansions?
One expansion is already underway, which I said that part of it will be commissioned, the LT cable, by May 2018, and HT portion will be commissioned by October or November 2018. So that will add to close to around 300 crore worth of or 400 crore worth of new capacity in 2018-19. Also, we have done some debottlenecking in our Silvassa plant, where we are manufacturing our house wires and flexible products. So there also we'll have an additional capacity of around 15% for 2018-19. The capex has already been done.
You had working capital days at around 95, I think. Is the working capital cycle improving now? Also, I mean, with respect to this, the high tension capacity that you will set up by the end of the year, is that going to be funded by debt? Then will debt levels overall increase in FY19?
No, this growth, this capex will be funded by internal accruals. Mm-hmm. We are not going to take any further debt. And also, the working capital level is around 95 days. We should remember the fact that our working capital in cables is close to around 80 or 85 days, but due to EPC segment, it grows to around 95 days because we have to have a lot of retention payments in the EPC business.
Okay. Can you tell us what your EBIT margins may look like in FY19?
It will be on the guided lines and
that's
definitely
what, 12%
somewhat better
margins?
Than the last financial year.
Okay.
I think last year we achieved around 10%, so okay. we can expect somewhere near, nearby that. Mm. So, yeah.
All right. We'll leave it at that. Thank you very much, Mr. Gupta, for joining us with all those details.